We were discussing how to make one of the poles dominant in the sense that it dominates the roll-off of the magnitude response and primarily determines the unity loop gain frequency, so that all the other poles and zeros in the system, parasitic poles and zeros, appear after the unity loop gain frequency. So this way essentially we are making a higher order system look more or less like a first order system. The loop gain of a higher order system look like the loop gain of a first order system, and that will be stable. Okay. Now, of course, these things can be rigorously proved as well. It turns out that if all the phase margin criteria I gave you, right? So these come from what is known as Nyquist criterion, which you will learn in control systems. So the fact of the poles being in the right half plane can be related to how the complex plot of the loop gain behaves on the complex plane in relation to the point minus 1. Okay. Now you kind of see that that's what we have done here also. We look at where the phase of the loop gain at the unity loop gain frequency and see how far away it is from 180. Essentially we are looking for how close we get to minus 1, loop gain being minus 1. Okay. And we don't want that. So we want some distance, and that distance we defined in terms of phase, saying that hey, the phase should be, the distance in terms of phase should be at least 60 degrees. Okay. So when loop gain crosses unity, we should have a phase lag of not more than minus 120 degrees or something of the sort. Okay. Well, like I said also, that the margin is always a subjective criterion, but you will never have a margin of 1 degree. That's not a robust system at all. Now, how do we actually do this in practice? So in principle, you have a number of poles in the system, and we can exclude inductors for the time being. Most of the parasitics will be capacitive when the sizes are small and frequencies are small. So by making one of the capacitors in the loop bigger, you can always stabilize the system. Okay. So now how big that capacitor has to be and so on, you may have to calculate. You will have to calculate. But if you, let's say, somehow imagine that this is not always true, that if you change one capacitance value, it's only one pole that changes. But for now, we can imagine that each capacitor is associated with a pole. So you can always make one of them bigger, and you have to go on making it bigger until the unity loop gain frequency falls to such a point where all the other poles and zeros are beyond the unity loop gain frequency. Okay. So this looks possible, right? The only thing is it may not be optimum. That is, given a number of poles, you may have to more intelligently choose which one to reduce. Okay. So given that, which, what would you do? Let's say without doing anything, the system is not very stable, at least the margin is not very good, and then you have a number of poles associated with a number of capacitors in the system. And for now, let's assume that these are all isolated, meaning each capacitor affects only one pole. So which one will you attempt to reduce? The smallest one, the one that's already lowest, right? So that way you will get the best bandwidth, because your bandwidth is limited by the unity loop gain frequency, and you have to make sure that that is smaller than every other pole, right? So obviously you will reduce the smallest of the poles. Now the example that we have been playing around with for a while is assuming that an op amp, when you try to make it, it needs two stages. Okay. Now this is not some arbitrary choice. It turns out that in most of the cases, two stages are what are practically chosen. Okay. So one stage typically gives you a gain that is too small, and also gives you other constraints that we cannot discuss now without discussing transistors. Turns out that if you typically make a one stage op amp, the swing limits, the saturation limits will be too far from the supply. Okay. So if the supply voltage is this much, you would like the output voltage to swing almost up to the rails. Okay. In fact, you would like the saturation voltages to be equal to the supply. Now that is not possible, because you will have some device and that needs some what is known as headroom. It needs some voltage across it. So it will be a little bit below the upper supply and a little bit above the lower supply. If you make a one stage op amp, that gap will be too much. It will be far below the upper supply or far above the lower supply. So one stage is not optimal from many points of view. They are used on integrated circuits in some cases where you don't care about these things. But when you make a general purpose op amp, it's invariably at least a two stage op amp. Okay. And in fact, a lot of practical op amps that you use in the lab happen to be two stage op amps, because two stages happen to give you enough gain. Okay. And how do you do that? You have one stage, each of which is represented by a voltage controlled current source and an inevitable parasitic capacitor that is always there. So I'll call this C1. And then the second stage. I hope you are comfortable enough with this notation. I have not said what this is, but this is GM1 times VE, right? And this is GM2 times the voltage that appears there, okay? So many times it's kind of common to write it like that. So this is really GM2 times VO1. That's the value of the current source. And we have C2. And as usual, to not confuse ourselves with loading and so on, I'll use a buffer, okay? So how would you do the frequency compensation? You can, let's say, increase C1 by placing another capacitor. That's very easy. To increase the capacitor, you have another capacitor in parallel. Now, in this picture, you can increase either one, but in practice, typically it turns out that the first stage output has a pole which is at a lower frequency than the second stage output, again because of some practical reasons. But in principle, you could reduce either one, okay? But of course, the problem with this, or at least the feature of this, is that we are not changing the second pole at all. So that means that your bandwidth is constrained to be smaller than the second pole, because you are changing P1, you are not moving P2. So you have to move the unity loop gain frequency within P2, right? So the bandwidth will be constrained by that one. Now, because of some other sort of unrelated reasoning, or we knew something else also, which was what? Miller effect, which was that if you have a negative gain amplifier and if you connect an impedance Z across it, then the input impedance looks like a smaller impedance Z divided by 1 plus A, okay? Now, instead of showing a general impedance, let me show a capacitor C. So then the input looks like a capacitor of value C times 1 plus A, right? So this is known as Miller multiplication. Now, this can be a problem in many situations, because you have an amplifier with a negative gain and you have what you think is a small capacitor between the input and output, but it can have a large effect, because if the input moves by some amount, the output moves in the opposite direction by a lot. So the actual voltage across the capacitor is a large amount, so the current will be very large also. So it's as bad as having a very large capacitor loading that node, okay? So sometimes this is a problem, but we can also use it. And the way I said we will use it is that, for instance, the capacitance that you connect here, C1 prime, comes out to be a large value, and it's in your interest to use smaller capacitors, because even in discrete components it costs less, and in IC definitely, because the area determines the cost and a larger capacitor occupies a large area and so on, okay? So instead of connecting a large capacitor from the output of the first stage to ground, I said that, hey, we use this, and this is how you design. You have analyzed the whole bunch of things and you know the results, and then you use something here and something there and combine different results to get whatever it is that you want, okay? So it's not as though every new circuit that you design has every element that is new. You don't go on inventing everything, right? It's usually putting together things that you know in an innovative combination. That's what engineering is. And so what did we say? So instead of using a large capacitor here, we will connect capacitor between these two, because the second stage here, right? For DC, it looks like an amplifier of gain. What's the gain? What is the gain? Minus GM2 by GO2, okay? So that we associate with this, some negative gain amplifier. Looks like, hey, we can get a larger capacitor for free by, or at least at a reduced cost, by connecting a small capacitor across the input and output. We also know that what is in this box is not exactly the same as this, because this we assumed is a voltage controlled voltage source. this is a voltage controlled current source loaded by a resistor. So we do expect the results to be different. But now that we have got the idea, you already know the analysis, okay? That's the first thing you learn in basic electrical circuits. So you analyze the response. Essentially, you have to calculate A of S and then see what happens, okay? So did you do that? What is A of S? What is the order of the system? Second order, okay? So it has two poles, that's it, and 1, 0, okay? So let me do this anyway, or at least set up the equations. This is a buffer, so the output voltage is the same as this actually, okay? Except that of course the buffer allows you to draw a lot of current and so on. And then we have CC. Now, like I said, I mean you can analyze it any which way you want, as long as you get the right result it's okay, but it pays to be systematic when you have these things. So let me call this V1 and maybe this VO. And we can write nodal analysis equations with these two as the variables, okay? This node voltage and that node voltage, okay? So what is the nodal analysis equation? So we have V1 and VE as the variables, and that's multiplied by the conductance or the admittance matrix, and that will be equal to the current source vector, okay? So that's what it is. And obviously, we have two variables in the variable vector. So, this will be a 2x2 matrix, okay? Please help me fill out the entries of the matrix. This nodal analysis using Kirchhoff's current law as the starting point, and when you use this, when you do this nodal analysis, you identify one node as the reference node and you do not write KCL there, and in the other nodes, at the other nodes you write Kirchhoff's current law, okay? So anyway, I mean I wanted answer for the main thing that I asked you. So if I have a circuit and I write these KCL equations and I express it like this, right? Something times V1 plus something times V2 VE equals the current injected here. Okay, what are these equations? Basically, I take this node and I sum all the currents flowing out of the node, and that is equal to an independent current source which is pumping current into the node, okay? So what should be the entries? That's correct. So what is that in general, I mean in a circuit? So if you, what are the diagonal entries in a conductance matrix? I mean, yeah, it is correct, okay, 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2, but what is that? I mean, just tell me in general terms in English. No, no, this has got nothing to do with input and output. I haven't even said what the input is. What is that? I mean, it's the sum of all admittances connected to that node, right? So, I mean, I think these things you should have. Let me take this very simple circuit, and again node 1 and node 2, the voltage here is V1, the voltage here is V2. I will call this G11, G12, G13, okay? If your matrix notation is confusing you, so let me just write KVL at node 1. What is it? Please help me. What I want is the independent stuff, independent current sources on the right hand side and the variables on the left hand side, okay? That's how you, that's the standard notation for writing linear equations, right? And then you solve for the variables on the left hand side. So just help me write the equation first. Solving is easier, I think. Mohan Prasad. Yeah. Yeah, start from the left side. Start from the left side, which is the variables. I want the independent stuff on the right side. V1 times G11. That's correct. So V1 minus V2 times G12. Okay, equals I1. So this is the current flowing out this way. This is the current flowing out that way, and that is equal to the independent current source that is pumping in current there. Okay. Now, when you write nodal analysis equations, you use V1 and V2 as variables. So you collect all the coefficients of V1 and all the coefficients of V2. Okay. And similarly at node 2, what is it? Nikhil? Nikhil? No Nikhil here. Surya Kumar? Not here. Sai Jitin? So many people are absent. You? Yeah. The second equation. What is it? I think we just did it, right? It's the Kirchhoff's current law, the second node. Deepak. R. Deepak. Raghav, yeah. Yeah, maybe I should let me call this G22. Okay. So V2 times. Yeah, that's correct. So you collect all the coefficients of V2 and what is the coefficient of V1? Minus V1 G12 equals I2. Okay. So if I write this in matrix form, okay, so that's all that's there to it. Matrix form is a nice compact way of writing it, and then you can also write the solution as matrix inverse times what is on the right hand side. Okay. So what are the diagonal terms? What is it? Total conductance connected at each node. Okay. So the term at kth row and kth column is basically the sum of all conductances connected to the kth node. Okay. And what is the entry at the kth row and lth column? What is that? Okay, like you look at the example, I think from there you can generalize, right? It's the negative of the conductance connected between kth node and lth node, that's all. And it's also symmetrical. Okay. So KL is the same as LK. Now, by the way, what kind of circuits is nodal analysis easiest? Have you done nodal analysis or not? Yes. What did you do? I mean, there is a certain kind of circuits for which nodal analysis is most convenient, and there is another kind of circuit for which mesh analysis is most convenient. So what kind of circuits is nodal analysis most convenient? Yeah, if you have only resistors and current sources. Okay. So in that case, this comes out to be symmetric. Now you can do nodal analysis in other cases also. It may not necessarily be symmetric and so on. So you have to look for that. Those cases. And similarly, mesh analysis is most convenient when you have only resistors and voltage sources. And by resistors, when you do this in the frequency domain, right, you can also include capacitors and inductors, because the VI relationship is exactly the same, Ohm's law, right, except that you have some functions of S in the proportionality constant, that's all. okay. But when you have dependent sources, these things will not be symmetrical, and when you have voltage sources, it can be inconvenient and so on. Okay. So, these things, I mean, if you are not familiar, please go back and brush up, because this analysis is something that you have to do all the time, right? I mean, these analysis methods are there for a reason, so that you can analyze circuit systematically and get the answer quickly, and also more importantly, whether you get it quickly or not without errors, okay? Because if you start writing equations ad hoc and eliminating variables and so on, it's much easier to make mistakes than if you write everything down systematically. So now help me with this stuff. So I have four elements in this matrix. What is 1 1? Huh? What is it? It's the sum of all admittances. Here we have frequency dependent components. We have to write these as functions of S. So it's the sum of all admittances connected to node 1. Okay? So what is that? GO1 plus? Yeah. GO1 plus S times C1 plus CC. Okay? So it's the sum of this admittance, and that one. Okay? So that's easy part. And similarly, what is the entry 2 2? I mean, you got this, you must get that, right? So what is the entry here? GO2 plus S times C2 plus CC. Okay? What's that? VO, yeah. Thanks. Okay? And what is this entry here and here? So let's say first one. Here, what is it? Minus SCC, okay? Simply because it is the negative of the admittance from node 2 to node 1. And what is it here? What is that? Essentially, that's the effect of node 1 on node 2, okay? What do you get? So you have minus SCC because of the capacitor that's connected. But you also have this controlled source, right, which is drawing current out of that node. So that will basically cause an asymmetry, and you will have minus SCC plus GM2, okay? Because V1 times GM2 is the current that is drawn out of that node, okay? So this writing this should be easy, okay? There is kind of, I mean, it's an algorithm. It's not even something that you have to think too much about once you understand what it is, okay? And the right hand side stuff, what is it? What is the independent current source here? Actually, this is driven by an independent voltage source VE, but this whole thing can be thought of as an independent current source GM1 times VE. Okay? So that's why this becomes a two node circuit. By the way, when you do hand analysis, this is a systematic way of doing it. When you set up equations on a computer, in fact, your circuit simulator uses this. Of course, by hand analysis, we won't be doing more than 2 by 2 because inverting the matrices and so on are a pain. But you can set up the equations and solve. Okay. So, what's the independent current source entry here? Minus GM1 VE, and here 0 because no independent sources connected there. Okay. Fine. Now you have to solve for actually V0. You can also solve for V1 if you want. How do you do that? What should you do? What should I do to solve this? Yeah. Yeah, yeah, you invert the matrix. How do you invert the matrix? I mean, there are ways to do that, I assume, you know. How do you invert a matrix? Hey, matrix inversion, you don't know or you don't? Huh? Yeah, there's some Gaussian elimination, all kinds of things that you can do. But when you are interested only in one variable, there is some way to solve this, right? What is it called? Somebody's rule. Cramer's rule. What is Cramer's rule? I'm only interested in VO, the output. So, how do I apply Cramer's rule here? What is Cramer's rule? Yeah, so for VO, tell me how to do that. Yeah, so for VO, which is the second variable, the second column of this is replaced by the right hand side source matrix. So, you will get something to take the determinant of this and divide it by determinant of the left hand side. This also, once you get used to it, this is actually easy, and this is a lot easier than writing equations ad hoc and then doing it. Okay. And what do you get? Here, of course, this is 0, so this is very easy. So, you will get okay. And in the denominator, you will get a second order polynomial in S. So, what is the coefficient of S square? S square comes from the product of these two and those two, right? So, what do you get? C1, C2. C2 CC plus CC C1. Okay, you get all the pairwise products. And what is the coefficient of S? So, let me do this like this. Let me collect the coefficient of CC. What is that? GM2 plus GO2. Okay. And then the coefficient of C1, which is GO2 plus the coefficient of C2, which is, actually, I think there was another term here. Okay. It's actually again simple. So, the coefficient of S, where does it come from, the first order term? So, it's plus. So, to get the first order term, you have to multiply this by that, or this by that, or that by that. So, you can collect all the coefficients and put it there. Then what is the constant? Where does the constant come from? This is the only place, right? G1, G2. Okay, we have got some slightly more complicated expression than the expressions we have got before. So, the first thing is sanity check. How do you do that? S equals 0. So, what should be the gain? What do you get here? Did I make a mistake in the sign somewhere? This should have been plus, right? So, GM1, GM2 by GO1, GO2. Basically, GM1 RO1 times GM2 RO2. So, that is the DC gain. So, that is correct. Okay. Any other? other sanity checks you can think of? I mean, basically reduce it to cases you have solved before. Which is that? What is the new element we introduced here? CC. So, what is the previous case? CC equal to 0. So, what should you get with CC equal to 0? Two poles, and you also know the values of the poles. What is that? The denominator becomes S square C1 C2 plus S times all the CC terms goes away, right? C1 GO2 plus C2 GO1 plus GO1 GO2. So, this can be factored, right? SC1 plus GO1 times SC2 plus GO2. So, where are the poles? GO1 by C1, that is 1 over RO1 C1, and then GO2 by C2, 1 over RO2 C2, as they should be. Okay? So, these are all sanity checks that you should use whenever you see any complicated expression. Okay? So, that is fine. Now, we have got a second order denominator, that is two poles and one zero. Where is the zero? What is the, at what frequency? GM2 by CC. So, that is something new that we had not expected, right? In that we said, we thought that it will be the same as the previous circuit as increasing C1. But it is not, it is qualitatively different, and the reason is that the second amplifier is not a voltage controlled voltage source like we used in Miller effect, analyzing Miller effect, it is actually a voltage controlled current source. So, we have something. So, finally, we have to analyze the effect of all of these things to see mainly, I mean the idea was this will do frequency compensation, that is it will make the two poles further, take the two poles further apart from each other and you will have good phase margin and so on. So, we have to analyze if it does that. So, how do we do that? We have to find the resulting poles, right? Okay, so please solve. How do you go about solving this? Where are the poles of the circuit? This is also quite simple, right? All you have to do is clearly, that can't possibly be the thing we do by hand analysis. So, what approximations do you know? You have to solve a quadratic equation under some assumptions. You have to know approximations to be an engineer, okay? Otherwise, there is no engineering. So, how do I mean, there is some approximation I could possibly use. C is small, okay. How many values of x satisfy this equation? 2, right? Obviously, it is a second order equation. And we can somehow assume that one of the values is such that we have to verify this later. Many of the assumptions are like this. You make some assumption and then later you see whether it is correct or not, because if it gives you a big shortcut, what is the big deal? You do that and then you can verify, otherwise it is not even solvable. I mean, there is no way, even if I write the answer, I am sure I can write the expression, it will take first of all the whole page and I cannot make any sense of it, that is a bigger problem. So, let us assume that x1 is such that these two terms are much more than that, okay. So, we can later verify if that is the case. So, these two terms are much more than that. So, I will neglect C altogether and then write that. And maybe the other value x2 is such that this one and this one are much more than that one. Okay? So, Bx2 plus C approximately equals 0. Okay? So, what are the two values? We have reduced them to first order equations, right? That is the approximation here. The quadratic equation has become two separate first order equations which can be solved by inspection. What is x1? Minus b by a. And what is x2? Minus c by b. And what will you calculate? I mean, okay, we made these assumptions, right? And then You have to verify. What is it that you will verify? X1? Yeah. So basically the magnitude of X1 must be much more than the magnitude of X2. Actually, it turns out that is exactly what we are looking for also, right? When we do frequency compensation. What are X1 and X2? There are P1 and P2, the poles. We want the poles to be far apart. So in the systems that are of interest to us, this will actually be true. So this is actually, although this looks very crude, it's a very useful approximation. Okay? Because of course P1 and P2 being close to each other, our approximation fails, but we don't want that kind of system anyway. So we have to look for systems where P1 and P2 are very far apart from each other. So I'll do that. And I'll just change the notation slightly. I'll assume P1 is the smaller pole like I've been doing so far. So where is the smaller of the poles? If I, the denominator, I should be able to write the denominator as approximately S by P1, S plus P1 times S plus P2. P1 is the lower frequency pole, P2 is the higher frequency pole. Actually, I mean in this case, as I have noted before, the poles are at minus P1 and minus P2. Okay. So what is P1? And what is P2? It's that CC times GM2 plus GO2 plus GO1 plus C1 GO2 plus C2 GO1 divided by C1 C2 plus C2 CC plus CC C1. So this looks quite painful, but we will make some approximations and see. Okay. So we spent a lot of time, I mean, on Kirchhoff's current law and so on, so we are not able to finish it now. But you take these expressions, and without CC, where were the poles? Without CC, I mean, when we didn't have CC, GO1 by C1 and this is GO2 by C2. So now what you want to compare is roughly how this compares with this and that compares with that. Okay? So very quickly tell me, P1, has it come down to lower frequency or moved to higher frequency or is it similar? Now for this you have to use some knowledge of GM1 and GO1, right? Which one is likely to be more, GM1 or GO1? GM1, obviously. GM1 by GO1 is the gain, which should be much more than 1. So this is where the engineering stuff comes in. So far it's just algebra. Okay? So based on that you tell me whether this has increased or decreased or what has happened. If you add CC. And similarly the other one, okay? Please think about this, and this I cannot emphasize enough. If you are not familiar with like formal, I mean not, I would say not say formal, but systematic circuit analysis, please go back and refresh yourselves, okay? Because you have to do this all the time. I mean there is no way around it. So please think about this. What we have done is we connected a capacitor between the input and output of the second stage based on the intuition behind Miller effect that we will get a larger capacitor. But the analysis reveals something quite different qualitatively, that you have also a zero. Okay? So you have a system with a zero and two poles, but we can analyze it and see whether it provides any benefit at all. Okay? Difficult analysis is fine. If the benefit is good, we can take it. And this analysis is not all that difficult. You need to work at it a little bit. But as usual, when you solve anything, you please think about what the solution comes out to be, okay? And it is also practically very important because most of the op-amps do look like this, okay? You have two stages and there is a capacitor across the second stage.